Hi, Casey kids. I'm so glad to see you guys here today. Sorry, I'm a little sleepy. I was staying up really late last night, and now I'm tired. And do you ever wish you had like more hours in the day? Maybe you doing an art project and you're like, I want to keep going, or you're just playing outside with your friends and you're like, I don't want to go home yet. And your mom's like, it's time for dinner, and you're like, why? Why can't we have more hours? Well, who created the days? If you said God, you'd be correct. Did you know that God actually messes with time sometimes? Yeah, he sure does. That's what our story today is about. So, let's talk about that now that I'm awake. Okay, are we ready? First of all, before we get to talk about how God messes with time, I hope you've been memorizing your big picture question. Do you have it yet? How can we glorify God? We can glorify God by loving him and being and obeying him. Sorry, I was gonna say being obedient to him. Do the same thing, either way, okay? Say it again. How can we glorify God? We can glorify God by loving him and obeying him. And God created us to love him, and we know his ways are best. And we glorify him by showing through our actions, our words, that we believe the truth about him. He is perfect, and it is right for us to love him and obey him. So glorify him, loving him, and obeying him. Got it? Good. Okay, so last few weeks, we've been talking about some pretty crazy stories, right? We've got Joshua and the people of Israel, and they were trying to go into the promised land, and God led them across the river, which he parted the waters to do it, right? They didn't just build a bridge. God was like, I got this. Move. And the waters moved, didn't they? So cool. So then they part it, and they stacked up the 12 rocks to show and everyone to remember the miracles that God did, right? And then they see the city of Jericho, and they're like, oh, that's a really big city. What are we going to do about this? And God said, well, here's the deal. I want you to march around the city for 7 days. No, you're not going to be shouting insults at them. No swords. No, you're not digging under the city. No dynamite. Nothing like that. You're just going to march around the city one time for 6 days. And on the seventh day, you're going to march around the city 7 times, and then you're going to shout really loud, and then you're going to see what happens. And the people of Israel went, okay. And they did. And what did happen? That's right. Those walls came crumbling down, and they were able to take over the city of Jericho. That's a pretty incredible story, isn't it? I know. I just love it so much. Okay, so the people have defeated their enemies here. And then as time goes on, they go on to defeat more and more enemies. And God just does some incredible things to give the people, his people, the promised land that he said he was going to give them today. And our story today is about another one of those battles in which God literally was messing with time in order to make sure that the Israelites would win the battle. And it is just so cool and amazing. So let's pray. And I can't wait for you to watch this video. Lord, thank you for being the God of time and for controlling everything from the sun and the moon and the stars and our planet, the universe. It's awe-inspiring when we think about how much you actually have control over every little thing. I pray you'll give us listening ears and open hearts to you today as we listen and learn about how incredible you are. In your name we pray, amen. All right, let's watch our video, Taking the Land.
God was with his people as they entered the promised land. Joshua and the Israelites had defeated the cities of Jericho and Ai. They made peace with their neighbors, the people of Gibeon. One day, the Israelites came to a place ruled by 5 kings. The kings did not love God or worship him. They had heard about God's people and were afraid.
One king called to the other 4 kings in the land. He said to them, help me attack Gibeon, because it has made peace with Joshua and the people of Israel. So the 5 kings joined forces and went up with all their armies to fight against Gibeon. The men of Gibeon sent a message to Joshua, help us, save us. All the kings who live in this land are fighting against us. So Joshua and his whole army went to Gibeon to help them. The Lord said to Joshua, Do not be afraid of the kings, for I have handed them over to you. Not one of them will be able to stand against you."
Joshua and his army marched all night from where they were staying, and they surprised the five kings' armies. As the Israelites fought, God confused the king's armies and helped Israel defeat their enemies. The five king's armies fled. The Lord sent hail from the sky to stop them. The battle was not over. Joshua needed more time to fight before the sun went down. So Joshua prayed to God, "Sun, stand still over Gibeon, and moon over the valley." The sun stood still and the moon stopped until Israel and Gibeon defeated the kings.
The sun did not set for almost a full day. There has been no day like it before or since. As the Israelites traveled in the Promised Land, they took over many other cities. God fought for his people and helped Joshua and the Israelites conquer the land God had promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
God gave the Israelites peace and rest from their enemies for many years. When Joshua was old, he reminded the Israelites about all the great things God had done for them. The people said, "We will worship the Lord because he is our God." Then Joshua died.
Joshua's name means "The Lord is salvation." God fought for Joshua and the Israelites, saving them and giving them victory over their enemies. Sinners can look to God for victory over sin and death. God brought us salvation by sending his son, Jesus, to die on the cross and rise again.
So, confusion, hail, the sun standing still, time holding still, what in the world? God is, like, incredibly powerful. If you haven't figured this fact out yet, this story should hopefully wake you up to the fact that we serve an amazingly, incredibly powerful God. And if he is gonna defeat somebody, he's gonna do it with style.
With style.
Okay? There was no way Joshua could have ever caused any of that to happen by his own power. Can you make it hail? Can you stop the sun? Yeah, I didn't think so. Only God can do that. God made the sun stand still, and he gave his people victory. God can literally move heaven and earth to help his people, and he'll do it too. If that's what he needs to do, he will stop time for you in order to help you. Isn't that amazing? And don't miss the fact the Israelites had marched all night long. They were tired. They had been marching and they're like, "Oh, we're so tired." And yet God gave them the strength to keep fighting even when they should have just been keeling over from exhaustion. Instead, all of a sudden they're like, "Oh, we're good. We've got like major caffeine God buzz going on here." Okay, that's what God gave them. God proved time and time and time and time and time and time and time again to the Israelites that he is faithful. God makes promises and he keeps his promises. And when the people of Israel love him and obey him, his glory would go on ahead of him. And he would cause their enemies to literally just run away in fear because they're like, "This God is crazy and he can stop the sun. Who knows what he's going to do?" Joshua's name means "The Lord is salvation." Remember, we talked about that a couple weeks ago. And God's promise to give the people a land of their own was finally fulfilled at the end of Joshua's life. Okay? Joshua was the leader who brought them the salvation of their own land. And God, though, was the one who gave them victory in that land. Joshua, he was a good leader. But he was a good leader because he had God on his side doing incredible things like crumbling buildings and making it hail and stopping the sun and all of this amazing stuff, right? When we begin to understand how great and glorious God is, it makes sense that we want to give God glory, okay? It's not just a case of, "Oh, I have to glorify God." You should want to give God glory because, let's face it, this God can make the sun stand still and the moon stand still if that's what he wants to do. So how can we glorify God? Well, we can glorify God by loving him and obeying him. But here's the hard part, okay? God's people, even after everything they saw God do, they still would forget God and they would sin against him. And they were focused on glorifying themselves. And we're gonna see in some coming weeks that even though God gave them the promised land and even though they were living there and it was amazing, they still would not perfectly obey God's rules about the land. Only one person in history has ever been perfectly obedient to God. Who was that? Right, only Jesus, and only Jesus ever perfectly glorified God. And that's why it's so important to look to Jesus for that glory. Remember, God rules, he's the king, and we've all sinned, but he provided us Jesus, the perfect, obedient, loving son. And Jesus gave us new life, he gives us hope, and we have a future with him. And it's up to you and me to decide how we're gonna respond. Are we gonna obey God? Are we gonna say, yes, God, I love you and I trust you? Or are we gonna say, yeah, I know you can hold the sun and I know you make great cities crumble and I know you can make water split apart and do all these cool things, but now I'm gonna do my own thing. Are you gonna go that way? Or are you gonna say, God, you're pretty amazing and I know that you've got control and love over my lives and I'm gonna ask you to be king of my life? Those are the two choices we have every single day of our lives. I hope you make the right choice. Now, let's go back to the Israelites for just a minute. Do you think the Israelites were afraid going into the battle? Yeah, I would say so. Because even when we know God is on our side, is it still normal to be afraid of things sometimes? It really is. But how do we get peace then? Well, peace comes from God. And peace comes from knowing and putting into our hearts and our minds and our hearts that God cares for us and he loves us and he is with us and he knows exactly what we're going through, where we're going, when it's gonna all be over, what's gonna be coming at the end of it. He knows all the answers already. So when we trust in Jesus, when we follow him, one of the things Jesus gives us is peace in our lives. Even if our lives are difficult, God can still give an amazing peace. And there are stories throughout history of people, even beyond the Bible, of people who go through incredibly difficult experiences. And some people who even give up their lives for the sake of telling other people about God. And God still gives them peace and gives their family members peace and the people around them peace because they know God is in control. And that is not a human peace. That is not something we can just get for ourselves. That only comes from God. So with that question, I want you to go back to our key passage. You ready? So say the key passage with me. The Lord is the one who will go before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you or abandon you. Do not be afraid or discouraged. Okay, that goes right along with this question. God goes before us. He's with us. He's not going to leave us. He's not going to abandon us. We don't have to be afraid or discouraged because he is going to give us peace because we know that he is in charge of our lives. And the miracles in the Bible remind us of God's great and incredible power. The same God who fought for Joshua, the same God who fought for the Israelites is the same God who is with you today. And he is never going to leave you. You to hold on to that promise. So keep watching. I want you to watch to the end of this. We've got the song that goes with our key passage. It's a good way to put it in your brains and hearts. And again, if you memorize the big picture question and the key passage, have your parents film it and send it to me. Even if you can't come to church, you can still be a part of our drawings for prizes because we want you to know that we love you and you are still important to us even if you're not with us every Sunday. And I encourage you to keep doing that. Let's pray, and then I will see you guys next week. God, thank you for being a God who will stop time for your people. You are incredible. I pray that you will help us to remember that and see that in all the times when we're afraid or discouraged that we don't have to be because you are a God who brings peace and you are a God who brings victory. I pray for every person listening that they may come to know you and serve you always. In your name we pray, amen. I will see you guys next week. Hang out and sing our song with us. Bye.